Won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime. No help from my friends. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz?
This is the Mercedes-Benz 220 SEB. This particular vehicle has a build date of late 1965. I wanted to point out some of the design elements and features of this particular car, concentrating mostly on the exterior look and styling rather than the engineering, which I'm certainly not qualified to talk about. I think it's undeniable that this car is not an example of form follows function, because while the engineering is solid and reliable, the exterior shape is all about the look. In the 1960s and 70s, Mercedes produced sedans, coupes and cabriolets with the chassis type
W111.
They were produced for 11 years from September 1960 to July 1971. They were also known by the nickname of Heckfloss, which is German for fin tail, due to the small fins at the rear present on the sedan, but which evolved to a much more rounded shape on the coupe and cabriolet. I've decided to produce this video because of the interest it generates any time it rolls out of the garage. It might just be because it's old and looks so different from current batch of look-alike vehicles on the roads, but personally, unless I can see the badge, I can't tell one model of vehicle from another. I would suggest that in the 60s, it was possible to distinguish the different car brands just by the profile. Compare, for instance, all these models from 1965, the Jaguar, a Rolls-Royce, Cadillac, Holden and Valiant, all distinguishable at a glance. Consider that if Stuttgart had been in East Germany in the 60s rather than West Germany, Mercedes may have looked like this, the 1963 Trabant 600. Recently, I had the car parked on the street and the postman doing his round stopped and asked if he'd take a photo. He then walked on past my neighbour's current model AMG Mercedes and didn't give it a glance. So admittedly I'm biased, but I think the styling of this car is special now, and it was special when it was built. The W111 rather series was designed to incorporate many pioneering safety features that we take for granted today, possibly the most important being a crumple zone. These vehicles were the brainchild of Mercedes design engineer Bela Bereny, who was regarded as the father of passive safety in the automotive design. On Mercedes' website, he is credited with first conceiving the original design of the Volkswagen Beetle in 1925, 5 years before Ferdinand Porsche claimed to have made his initial version. The 220 was first released as a four-door sedan, followed a year later by the coupe. By the way, do you know why a chicken coupe has two doors? Of course, if it had four doors, it'd be a chicken sedan. While the coupe and later the cabriolet shared engineering features with the sedan, the job of developing the styling for the coupe went to Frenchman Paul Braque, who is credited with most of the styling for the Mercedes in the 60s and 70s. He also worked for BMW, Citroën and Peugeot. He even had a hand in the design of the French TGV high-speed train. My 220 SEB is one of the very last built before the introduction of the 250 SE later in 1965, and then the 280 SE in 1967. The 220 SEB Coupe was produced from September 1960 until October 1965. The lowercase b used in the model designation was used to distinguish from the earlier 220 SE Ponton, which is German for pontoon. From 1960 to 1965, 14,173 coupes were built. Of that number, only 776 were right-hand drive, and of that number, only 214 were imported into Australia by Mercedes-Benz Australia. So this car is potentially one of only 214 in the country. Because of the higher second-hand value of the Cabriolet, a number of coupes have had their roofs chopped off, which makes this car even rarer. Engine. The engine used in this car is the M127, a six-cylinder inline cast iron block with four crankshaft main bearings and cast alloy cylinder head with overhead cam and two valves per cylinder. The camshaft drive uses a duplex roller timing chain. This is a 2.2-litre engine producing 120 horsepower at 4,800 RPM, which is not much for a vehicle with a tare weight of 1,450 kilos. Compared with my Golf, which is 1,300 kilos and 147 horsepower, which is 10% lighter and 39% more power. The fuel economy for the coupe is about 17 litres per 100 kilometres, compared with the Golf, which is 6.5 approximately. It has Bosch fuel injection, which is mechanically driven and mechanically controlled, with only two fuel pump pistons feeding groups of three cylinders each, injecting into the intake manifolds, not directly into the cylinders. The acceleration is rated at 13 seconds, 0 to 60 miles per hour, and the claimed top speed is 105 miles per hour. Suspension. Front and rear suspension are basically the same throughout the production run, with low pivot swing arm in the rear, which mounts a longitudinal spring above the diff between the two halves of the axle at the swing point, and a suspension spring and shock absorber at the outside end of each axle. The front suspension consists of conventional coil-sprung wishbones. Brakes. Mercedes first introduced disc brakes in the 60s. The 220 SE was the first model with disc brakes on the front and drums on the rear. Braking effort is assisted by a vacuum booster. It has no ABS, and heavy application of the brakes will lock the wheels. Transmission. They are available with two manual transmissions with either 4 or 5-speed gearbox. I have the automatic option, which uses the Mercedes-Benz K4A025 4-speed gearbox. This gearbox has only two planetary gear sets. The gearbox earned the nickname of Jerk-O-Matic, and you certainly feel every gear change. On the other hand, it's performed faultlessly for the 188,000 kilometres the car's travelled so far. It's a characteristic of the gearbox that it never starts in first gear, irrespective of how steep an incline to be negotiated. To engage first gear, the gear change lever has to be shifted to the second gear position, which will then force first gear to be engaged. It will move off in first gear, but will then quickly change up to second gear automatically. An interesting feature is that the transmission is fitted with a hydraulic coupling rather than a torque converter. The fluid coupling uses an input impeller to pump fluid through to the output turbine, but lacks a fixed stator in between, which is used in a torque converter to increase torque where the engine is operating at low speed. It's reputed that it's possible to start the engine by towing the car in neutral and then engaging drive in the transmission, but I'm not sure if this is true, and I've certainly never been game to try it. Wheels. The 220 and later 300 SEB have 13-inch steel wheels with a two-part hubcap. The outer section is chrome and the inner section is painted the same colour as the car, with the Mercedes star in the centre. Originally, the car was supplied with white wall tyres, which I found hard to source. For practical purpose, I've settled for a tyre with a narrow white stripe. The original tyres were 725/13 nylon sport with an overall diameter of 654 mm. They've been replaced with 185/80R13. Bodies. The cabriolet is 80 kilograms heavier than the coupe to compensate for the lack of rigidity afforded by the roof of the coupe. Both models use the same doors, which are very heavy, which is noticeable when you open the door against a slope. They're constructed of a massive three-part alloy casting welded together and covered with a steel skin. The design is intended to reduce side intrusion in a collision. These doors are not to be paint stripped with caustic because you'll be left with just the steel skin. A distinctive feature of the front of the car is the vertical quad stacked headlights with a glass cover in the European models and individual lenses in the US models. The four sections of the headlight consists of the turn indicator at the top, the clearance light under that, the headlight in the middle, low beam and high beam, and fog lights on the bottom. The light control switch rotates to the right to activate the clearance lights and the headlights. Rotating the switch to the left to the first position activates just the right-hand clearance light, and to the second position activates just the left-hand clearance light. Fog lights are switched on by pulling the switch out. High beam is activated with a button on the floor. The Mercedes star is spring-mounted on top of the radiator. Later models have the star in the grille, presumably to prevent theft. The door locks feature a safety pin designed by Barenghi, which are intended to stop the door bursting open in an accident. The overall length of the body is 4,876 mm, just 74 mm shorter than a Toyota Land Cruiser. Yet despite the length, for practical purposes, this is only a two-seater. Many of the online reviews claim that the car can comfortably accommodate five adults. This may be true for the sedan, but certainly not for the coupe. If the driver's seat is adjusted to a comfortable driving position for the average size male, there is minimum leg room in the back. Small children would fit, but certainly not adults. Again, it's all about styling. I guess the bonnet has to be a certain length to accommodate the engine, and for balance, the boot is about the same length, which means the cabin is shorter, forcing rear seat to be further forward compared with the sedan. As a consequence, the boot is huge. The full-size spare wheel is mounted vertically in the right-hand side of the boot. There's a matching well in the left-hand side, which is very handy for storing small items where the well stops them from rolling around. For example, when you're carrying a bottle of wine. The fuel tank filler is located underneath the license plate in the center of the rear. This means you can pull up either side of a fuel bowser. No need to remember which side the fuel cap is on. The original tools that come with the car is a spark plug spanner, a screwdriver, variety of open-ended spanners, a pair of pliers, a wheel brace, this little thing, and I don't know what that does, and of course the jack. The tools are all labelled as Mercedes-Benz. Over the years, unfortunately, they've got a bit wet, so I've just treated them with rust converter, but other than that, just left them as they are. The jack mounts behind the spare wheel in that position there. Veneer. The dash and front windscreen surrounds are wood veneer. The two veneers available were boar walnut and Sobrano, a timber from Central Africa. This car has the burr walnut. There is obviously great skill employed with the application of the veneer on the complex curves, particularly for the instrument cluster, where the veneer was forced to bend in tight radius in two directions at once, from side to side and also from front to back. Try wrapping a basketball in paper with no creases or wrinkles. Can't be done, but Mercedes-Benz did it. Interior. The seats and door linings are leather. The rounded instrument cluster features large dials for the speedo and the tachometer, with a rectangular section between the two with gauges for oil pressure, water temperature, fuel gauge, low fuel light, charge warning light and handbrake warning light, and a dimmer control. The speedo is cable driven from the gearbox and the tacho is cable driven from the front of the engine. The speedo reads in miles per hour. The front seat back can be folded forward to allow rear seat passengers to get in and out. The handles are located either side of both front seats that have to be lifted to release the lock mechanism to allow the seat backs to fold forward to make room for rear passengers to get in or out. These handles are difficult to reach from the rear seat, so help from a second person standing outside the car is almost necessary. Things it doesn't have. There are a number of features that this car doesn't have that we consider standard equipment on modern cars. The most obvious is probably electronics. Everything in the vehicle is mechanical, even the clock. There are no solid-state items anywhere, so obviously no GPS and no engine computer. There are no seat belts. Lap belts may have been an option, but because there are no pillars, there is no mounting point for the sash belt. There's no rear window demister. No ABS. No cup holders. Just a standard AM radio. No music players. No air conditioning. No headrest. No turbo. No central locking. No electric windows. No keyless start or chipped key. Some features that this car does have that have largely disappeared from modern vehicles include vent quarter windows, which became unnecessary
with the introduction of air conditioning.
Ashtrays, good for storing coins. Column shift, leaves more space in the console. A hood ornament, good for aiming. Tail fins, really good for nothing. White wall tyres are hard to keep clean. But one important feature has good all-round visibility, largely obviating the need for a reversing camera. Thinking about the lack of engine control computer, I had an experience recently where the vehicle failed to proceed. In other words, it broke down. I called for roadside assistance, but when the mobile mechanic arrived, he took one look at the car and said, "Can't help you with that." He wouldn't even open the bonnet. With no computer to plug into, he was lost. I have noticed that when I have passengers who are not used to the car, they often have difficulty finding the door release to get out. It's initially confusing when they notice the various different handles and knobs on the door. Modern vehicles have just the one lever to open the door, and every other control is an electric switch. My dad bought this car for my mum, and here is a photo of my mum when the car was new. So this is the end of this video, and if you've made it this far, thank you for watching. If you have any questions, comments, or corrections, I'd love to hear from you. Thank you.